Hello and welcome to Pastors United. Today we have a special program regarding Pastors United. It's our Pastors United Youth Forum. I am Pastor Gregory Caffey, pastor of the Refuge Missionary Baptist Church, 8058 South Kimbark. Pastor Richard C. Walker is our emeritus pastor as well as the founder. We welcome you to our Pastors United Youth Forum, and we pray that God will enlighten you. There are some things that will be said that will cause you to think and to trigger your thinking and to understand that God is clear and there is clarity in His Word regarding instructions to our youth.
Amen. My name is Pastor Sylvester Jones. I'm the pastor of New Direction Missionary Baptist Church. We thank God for you this morning. And as Pastor Kathy has said, our prayer is that as we try to answer the questions for our young people, that would enlighten them in the Word of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I'd like to introduce our young folk today. We have our young folk from our sister churches as well as the Refuge Church, and they're going to be participating in the youth forum today. We're going to ask them to stand. You've just been introduced to some of our youth who are going to be participating in our Pastors United Youth Forum. To start off our topics of discussion, we thought it would be in our best interest to start from the beginning, where Satan's first demonic influence on man and woman. And we came up with this discussion because we understand that there are actually two demonic spirits that empower all other demonic spirits. And when you look around and you see what's going on in the world today regarding our youth, because we're targeting our youth today, there are two demonic spirits that Satan tries to infiltrate in the hearts and in the minds of our young people. And one is called insecurity, and the other one is called inferiority. Insecurity simply means it's a state of not being secure, not being confident, not being firm within yourself. The other demonic spirit is called inferiority. Inferiority means the state of feeling lower in position, lower in status, or lower in value. It is my prayer that when we are finished discussing this first topic, that you'll see and be clear on the demonic influence that the enemy is trying to bring on our youth. I'm going to ask Pastor Marshall, if you will, from Pastor Marshall. He's going to give us some clarity regarding these two demonic spirits. Spirits. And we'll move forward with Pastor Jones as well.
Insecurity are the spirits that we're dealing with here. Deals with when one has been stripped of their confidence of feeling safe. And that's one of the things that the enemy wants to do. And in most cases, that when we see our youth, there's a lack of feeling safe in their communities, feeling safe in school, and some are not even feeling safe in their homes. And so that's what the enemy wants. He wants to strip them of that and make them feel insecure in whatever area they're dealing. Not only does it It deals with from feeling physically safe, but it deals with also their spiritual person as well, that they don't feel safe in certain crowds that they're around. And it's not that they're feeling safe to in terms of physical, they're feeling unsafe in terms of speaking out when they see things that are not right. And spiritually, they know that it's not right and it bothers them, so they refuse to speak out in some instances. And in inferiority, we know that that's one of the biggest things that the devil puts upon us anyway, is that they're feeling of inferiority. He wants you to feel inadequate, as though you're not equipped, you're not good enough. So when Pastor Kathy brings out these two demonic forces that are actually at work, especially against our youth and some adults as well, but it's very clear cut that's what the enemy does to us. The devil comes so that what he wants to steal, kill, and destroy. So he uses those as his devices to try to hurt us at whatever level he can.
Amen. Again, and this is our program is geared towards our young people, and but it's also geared towards us as adults, that the enemy want us to feel insecure. And one thing I want you to understand, that when you are insecurity, it causes anxiety. You know, when you have anxiety, it will lead us to do things that is not of God. Insecurity. Satan wants you to feel insecure, unsafe. He wants you to feel insecure. It's kind of like no trust. You remove that. You feel insecure in the way you are, and especially with our people and our people of color. You know, Satan wants to rob you, make you feel less than what you are and who you are. Amen. Instead of being glad and happy of who God made you, and because the Lord chose you to be who you are, and the devil wants you to feel insecure. Sometimes young people feel insecure in their own homes, and so they look for it on the outside. And this is not a good either, because he wants you to feel that you can't make it at home, so you look for outside interference from others. So he wants you to feel insecure there, and then inferior when your value, like you don't mean much. You know, your value of who you are and what God has made you. And I want the young people to know this, that God made you black. That was for a purpose. God chose you to be this way. And all our people are beautiful. Amen. And handsome. Amen. God made you like that because that was his choice. You know, so when we start going into this, we find out that the enemy wants you to feel as though you are inferior to other people, and other people will try to make you feel that you are inferior to them.
Amen.
Hey man, well said, Reverend Jones, well said. I want to hone in on inferiority. Means the state of feeling lower in position, like you don't have the value, young folk, that other young folk have. Society has been the culprit, and not only society, but the media has really been the culprit of this undoing, because the media constantly tells the young people, if you don't have these Jordans, you're not cool. And y'all correct me if I'm wrong. If you don't have this, if you don't wear this type of hairstyle, you're not going to be accepted. Therefore, I want to show you how the enemy works, even through the media. Years ago, they used to have a commercial saying, if you didn't use close-up toothpaste, you wasn't going to get kissed by a good-looking person. Y'all follow me on that? So the media is very slick, and the enemy uses the media toward the young people. See, Satan has a hit out on the family, but he has his rifle of destruction aimed at the children. Mm-hmm. Because he knows that if he can get the children off course, they will be hard for the elders to deal with. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
And so I want to hone in on inferiority. There's another commercial that says, I'll go back to the Martin. Anybody ever saw Martin? Watch Martin. Remember Martin used to wear the shoes from the grocery store? He used to wear the gym shoes from the grocery store. And he used to walk real funny in those shoes. But and so I found myself saying, man, they gonna make fun of me if I wear something like that. Or they gonna look at me crazy if I don't have, a Hollister. If I don't wear, what's the latest brand, y'all? For holler it out, tell me. Come on. Forever 21. Now, I want to be Forever 21. But y'all folks, what are some of the other? Abercrombie and Fitch. Now, and I like it because Abercrombie and Fitch, they are really one of the main culprits, right? Because they said specifically that we only target children that are good looking. In our ads, that's what we're going to put out. We're only going to have good-looking kids to be the ones wearing Abercrombie and Fitch. Now, I'm not talking about nobody. I'm not trying to blame anybody, but I'm trying to understand this situation that our young folk are in. So I want us to hone in on that. Inferiority. Our young folks are feeling inferior, like they don't add up. And they're being told some things by their parents and loved ones that's making them feel inferior, like they don't add up, and making them feel insecure. And feel free to hone in. You feel free to jump in. Feel free, gentlemen.
Well, I want to ask the kids, if you don't wear a certain gear, certain clothing, does it make you feel inferior to other folks? Because I've heard some young men, that's why they say, well, they'll rob, they'll stick up, they'll do whatever they want. Because they got it, I don't have it. I'm going to have it because I'm going to take it. And that's one of the things that the enemy does too. You know, he puts that feeling that of inadequacy on them. And then they feel like, they'll just take it. The other day, a young man took my niece's phone. She had that big note phone. Galaxy Note 2. He was 15. They called him. She coming out the gas station on the phone, going to pump some gas. She's grown. She's 28. Something like that. She pumps gas. And a little 15-year-old boy. Mm-hmm. Snatched her phone. Then police called him. And the reason why I think they're doing it is because feelings of inadequacy. Anybody want to hone in on that? That got to speak up so they can hear you on the camera.
As far as material things go, no, I don't feel inferiority. I don't feel like that because I know that my parents are. I may not get the exact thing, but I'm going to get something similar to it. Or
amen.
And I'm not going to get it when everybody else get it. I'm going to get it when they're going to get it. So I know that eventually I may be blessed to get it if I ask for it. But no, I don't feel that way. And does it have to just be with material things? Can it just be the society itself?
And that's the question I was going to ask because I thought it should be.
Does it have to just be with material things? Can it be with things like around society?
Okay. But this is society I'm talking about.
I'm not talking
about anything that you see inside. Even I don't care if it's a rapper. You want to be like the rappers. You feel inferior because you say, oh, they all and they all, but no, anything. how do you feel? Is it society alone? Is it in the school? Is it in the neighborhood? Any of those things. Anywhere. It's not just dealing with just your little area. You feel inferior in any activity, anything in your life. No?
I feel like that all of us will have some type of inferiority, like in some aspect in life. Like for example, if we look at the magazines and see a model that's like picture perfect, we might say, oh, she's so pretty, and that deep inside, even though we don't want to admit it, we might want to be like her. Or if a boy sees a rapper and he has money, cars, and women, he might really want that. But I feel like inferiority should make you want to work harder, because it was for you, it's for you.
I want to rely on what she's talking about, because like I had a feeling about it. I feel like I want to take it, but I just think to God, like, would it be the right thing or would it be the wrong thing? And I rely to myself on what happened to me. But I do be feeling that sometimes, like, if somebody have a better phone than me, I'll be wanting to take it, but I just think to God. And I tell him, like, should I take it or should I not? The devil on my side, it will. It'll be like the devil on my left side my, and the God on my right side just be pulling me, asking me questions and all that. But I felt that way before. I don't want to feel no more.
Praise God.
I feel that in some cases there are inferiorities because, like, for example, I have a friend in school and he doesn't have like all the type of clothes as he wants to, and sometimes he gets picked on and bullied because of the clothes that he wears, the clothes that he has. So I feel that in some cases there are inferiorities.
Yes, I just wanted to make a statement when the question was posed, because the Spirit had led me to think about me as a youth and for your inferiority. And I think that the young lady here was kind of like trying to get that. And we was focusing on material things, but I remember as a youth that I had two parents and I never wanted for nothing. However, I had other adults who didn't have much, and they was always putting me down as a grown folk, as a grown person. And if it wasn't for me being in a spiritual family, I could have grew up with that, and then that could have led to other things, but it came from someone else. It could come from anything outside of material things, your family members, people, and it is society as a whole. So I just wanted to just kind of like, just make that statement so that they could, you know, search their inner self for all of the things that could trigger that. And that's what I'm saying.
I'd like to pose a question regarding these two demonic influences, insecurity, and inferiority. Young folk, how do you feel about the media? And there are all types of media out there now. We now know that cyberspace, everything's in cyberspace. There's nothing you can actually do now without it being going viral. Well, how do you feel about the media and how it plays a part in young folk feeling insecure or having a spirit of inferiority?
Well, I think the media do show that you're supposed to like be like light skinned, have long hair, have all this nice jewelry and stuff and all that. But it's really what's inside, and this makes you, sometimes the media can make you feel like down about yourself, like you're not that good of a person, but it's not that.
Amen.
Amen.
I think that the media persuades you to do things that you may not want to do. Like, for example, in school we had this, we had to go to the auditorium to watch a movie called Persuasion. And it was all about how the media pressured you to do things. This man was talking about how he was pressured into smoking when he didn't want to because he thought it was cool because his friends were there. So that's what I think it was.
Amen.
kind of rely on what he said too. Like, the internet, like, it's like cyberbullying to me. It bully people, like, it put pictures of people, like, to put their one put up there and have, they can design pictures to make them look bad and all that. But cyberbullying is another reason why, like, it can be suicide. That's a bad thing.
Come on. I have a question. As young Christians, even all of you are now Christians of church and believe Jesus Christ, right? Okay. As young Christians, when you see things that you know, even if the media is portraying, if it's portrayed on Instagram, or if it's Facebook, what's that other?
Twitter.
And you see it, you know that it's not right. You see some of the postings, the pictures, things of that nature. You know it's not right. As a Christian, does it influence you to say, look how many hits they got on? Oh, look, they Instagram famous fuck. What are they portraying themselves as Christians? And how do you feel? Do you feel like, well, maybe are you leaning towards doing that? Because you want, you know, that prestige and stuff like that. You want to be seen, you want to be famous. So anybody want to take that? From a Christian perspective.
As a Christian, when I see the stuff on Instagram and Facebook and everything, especially with females exposing their bodies, I don't like it and I don't feel like I should do it. But as far as them portraying homosexuality and things, it's kind of hard. Because now, one day your friend will be fine. They like boys, or your male friend, he likes a girl. But then the next day, they like the same sex. Mm-hmm. And then you don't know what to do because that's your friend. You don't want to say, okay, you're not my friend anymore. Mm-hmm. Because they've been your friend all that time. And then it's hard because you know that, okay, from the teenager standpoint, I want to be their friend. But as a Christian standpoint, you know it's not right. So it's kind of hard.
Amen.
Wow. Amen. Well said.
I can relate what she's saying because I have a friend, she exposed her body on Instagram. And sometimes I try to talk to her, but she be like, that I can do it whatever I want to. And sometimes I start to tell her mom, but I'm like, I ain't gonna say that. Tell her mom because I know what her mom gonna do, but she act grown. She do things that she don't supposed to do. She pierce her body. I tell her not to do it, but sometimes I be like, sometimes I be thinking in my head saying, I don't want to be her friend, but we've been friends too long. We get into arguments all day. But I can relate because she exposed her body and I tell her not to do it.
I feel like a lot of people, even Christians, like that's in the church, teenagers, a lot of people lead a double life. Like one minute they're in the church praising the Lord and everything, and then the next minute they on Instagram or Facebook talk about they homosexual and they even had it from their family members. But I think like Pastor Kathy said, the devil targets the kids and aim his rifle at the kid because he wants them to be confused, and that's a sense of insecurity when you can say, one minute, oh, I like boys. The next minute, oh, I like girls. But that's because they don't really know who they are.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. To just piggyback off what she said, now with certain things, you have some teenagers with, you know how all teens like to do trends, the trendy thing, everything that's in. Now it's like certain things are a trend and you don't want to be a part of that trend, but if you're not doing it, you get talked about. And it's kind of hard because you being that teenager, you like, oh, forget it. The Lord forgive me. I repent. But then on the inside, deep down inside, you like, okay, my daddy gonna kill me. My mama gonna kill me. I'm gonna have to hear the church folk talk to me. So you have to think about all that before you make the decision. And it's really hard. So like she said, the devil does target the youth, and now it's getting worse and worse. Especially for the Christians,
those who believe and actually are rooted in the word, it's kind of hard for us because you want to do what everybody else doing, but you don't want to be punished for that one little action.
Amen.
Off the top of your head and how you feel about it as a person who is in the church.
As a young Christian, I feel that some people with the homosexuality and being bisexual, I think something may have happened to them in the past, which led them to think that.
Come on.
Well, I think about homosexuality and everything. It's really just, they don't really care no more. It's like, it's just a trend, really. Like, everybody's doing it, so they're like, why not do it? They don't take it as a serious note.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on.
With the homosexuality, it's, well, number one, a lot of girls are going, they're becoming lesbians because some of the boys, if the boys are not either locked up, dead, or they're gay, it's kind of how you don't have anybody to be with. So they turn to each other. And then that's where they found love. They found love in each other. So I think number one is because they're lonely and they want a boyfriend, but they can't find one. And then also they're confused because you don't necessarily, you can't just outright one day and just say, oh, I'm gay, I like girls. And then you just walk around just touching. You're confused. You're just doing it because everybody else is doing it. And sometimes, like my brother said, sometimes they go through things where, you know, maybe they were raised with a touch or something that will cause them to go that way. But like she said, I think it's a trend, and it's also just because they're home.
Amen.
I want to say what she said too. Like, I think that girls and boys is becoming lesbians and the homosexuality is because, like, their facial expressions, the way they don't like how they shape or what color their skin is.
Come on.
And another reason I think that they are becoming lesbians on that is because how, not trying to get on the boys, like, because boys treat girls wrong, and I know that. I have done it one time. They treat them wrong, and they treat them like they ain't nothing. They like dirt on the earth.
Come on.
I heard that boys, I mean girls, like, okay. Girls, they don't can't find no boys, so they turned out to be gay, lesbian, or bisexual and all that. And then boys, when they can't find a girl, they turn themselves out to be gay. Because some people around my house, they can't find a girl or a boy, so they just turn out bisexual because they can't find nobody to be with.
Well, I think, like, some Christians, they think it's just cute and all, and they think really that God accepts it or something. Because, like, it's portrayed on television, all these shows, with marriage, a gay wedding and stuff, but I really think they just think it's cute and God is something.
Well, I think it's deeper than like how they look, because it's like some of the most attractive people are gay now. Mm-hmm. I think it's something spiritual, and I think it all relates back to insecurity because they don't feel like safe within themselves. So they don't necessarily know what to do, and a lot of them know it's wrong because they have tattoos like only God can judge, but they don't know where to go or who to look to when they have those feelings of like, you know, oh, I want to be with a man, I want to be with a woman.
Come on.
I like their answers, and even as a young man, I'm only 21, and I a lot of stuff that they're saying I've experienced. I've had friends that have experienced it. I mean, some of us, we grow up in neighborhoods, or for myself, we grew up in households or around family members where this is the status quo, in a sense. This is what makes them feel I can't be like them, or I can't be accepted because all of my brothers and sisters, or my cousins, my aunties, my uncles, they're all living this lifestyle, and they seem to be so happy, so I want to be happy, so why can't I be like them? And you get a lot of family members or a lot of adults that they look up to that tells them, well, God loves everybody. And if God loves everybody, why would God send you to hell because you chose to love a person that makes you happy? And you get a lot of times where adults tell children, do what makes you happy, follow your heart. And a lot of times that can lead you to get in trouble. And we find that a lot of our young people, and even myself, I even have friends now in my age bracket that I've been friends with for years. And it is hard. I can agree with you when you've been friends with them and you know what the Bible says. You go to church every Sunday, you pray, you fast, you believe in what God says about you. And he said it, and you just fool enough to believe what God said is what it's going to be. And when you have friends and you know what they're doing is an abomination, or you know what they're doing is against what God has written in his doctrine and his principles, it's hard for you to be their friend and still stand on what God says, because at one point you will find yourself telling them what the Bible says or what God said this about what you're doing, and either way it goes, it puts a wedge between your friendship, because one, either they're going to be your friend or you're going to lose them as a friend. And then it'll get you to question your Christianity. And when it comes to insecurity, they were awesome with the insecurity, because that plays a big part too, because as a kid I was insecure. I understand what they say. Some of us grew up with households with two parents, one parent, and now in today's society, we have two of the same sex parents raising children. And we have society telling them, oh, it's okay because we have kids that, we have a man and woman that's over a household that's throwing children in dumpsters or leaving them at firehouses by themselves. So what's the difference in a man and a man or a woman and a woman raising children when they have better outcomes? And it's always being politically incorrect. It's being always from a political or statistical standpoint, but they never look into the depth of what it's doing mentally to a person. And it's kind of hard, because I can relate to this, because this was me. And I mean, I had people telling me, you know, you never be nothing, you won't amount to anything, that's just stupid, I don't even know why you believe in God, why would you read a man-made Bible? See, everybody try to find a reason to say why scripture contradicts scripture, because they try to justify or condemn other people to justify themselves what they're doing. Like they say, you have hypocrites in the church, that's where you'll find majority of them. And the thing about it in the church, like they say, you live in a double life. You're a Christian by day and a sinner by night. And it just don't make sense. And I can understand, not even on a spiritual level, but even on a personal level, I can understand where they're coming from. And on a spiritual level, like they said, it's hard to have a friend. And we got some pastor kids up here on the podium, so it's maybe a little bit harder than them, because you're at home with someone that's rooted and grounded in the Word of God. So you're studying probably more than other friends. You're living according to the doctrine of God. So it's kind of hard for you to break or for you to go and do something that's against God's will, or to have a friend that's doing it against God's will, and you know it's wrong. And you know what happened to you, but you can't. You know what I mean? That's all I wanted to say. So I mean, I applaud them. I understand exactly what they're saying.
I have a question for you. Because I know you all are Christians and you have been raised in a church, majority of you have. My question to you is, do you feel like you're forced to be a Christian? Do you feel that you're forced to be a Christian, or do you feel that your heart belongs to God true? Or I just want you to elaborate on your, how you feel with that. Do you feel that because you are raised in a church that you if you was to venture off, you will be condemned or looked down on, or you just choose the right path? That's my question.
Okay, I feel like as a child, like 9, 8 years old, when I was first started coming to church and everything, I was like, oh, they always make us go to church, I'm going to be playing outside, and all that stuff. But then as I grew older and as my mentality matured, I feel like I'm obligated to come to church because I owe God. He don't owe me nothing, because he wakes me up every morning. He do everything he needs to do, everything he want to do for me.
So it's not even a question like, are you going to church today? No, I'm going to church today because of, I mean, he woke me up. He woke me up so I could even get asked the question. And I mean, it's no simpler than that.
Like she said, when I was younger, I used to think that I was just being forced to go. I did not want to go to church at all, like, period. I would, like, almost cry because, you know, I was there every Sunday. Because my dad passed, I was there every Sunday singing in the choir on the usher board. But as I got older, I'm not that old, but as I got older, I realized that I did need to go to church. And it wasn't just because they were forcing me, it was because I needed to praise God for that week, to praise God for what happened and thank him for what was going on, because people die every day, and it could have been me, and that was my time to go say thank you. And now that I have gotten older, I have tried to learn the word more and pay attention more. It's still, some days I still had a Sunday where something's going on, and I got to miss it, and I still want to be like, oh man, I really got to go to church. But I have learned to deal with it, and I have learned that I need to go, and I need to pray.
Amen. Amen.
Yes. I want to pick back off of it. I want to piggyback off of what those two said. Like she said, you owe him to come to church. I mean, you should take time out to come to church because 6 days out of a week you're on your own. But when Sunday comes, you know, it's time for you to go to church and to give him the praise. I feel as if that if he woke you up this morning, that you should be grateful and glad that he even woke you up this morning. Like she said, people are dying everywhere. I mean, you don't know when you're next or when people say things like that. But I think that you owe him enough to come to church and to give him praise and to learn more about him, to understand why he sent you to where you are at now.
And I feel like on Sunday, it's to get your focus back on God, because like during the week, you probably wander off and like you're not really focused on God. Sometimes he's not the first thing on your mind. But that I use church as my rock, you know, to give me back focus on God, because sometimes I do kind of wander off.
Sometimes I think that I'm being forced to go to church, but then again, since I turned 10, I think that it's my choice to go to church because I love the Lord. But still, sometimes I want to go hang out with my friends, you know, like play outside and watch TV, but I don't. So I think that's good that I still go to church every Sunday.
Israel. I watched a documentary about how like it relate back to the media and how they like portray stuff, and we don't even know it, but they corrupting our mind. I found out that Disney Channel, like the kid site, does like got Illuminati in it, and Mickey Mouse is like supposed to be a symbol of Illuminati, and I feel like it's sad, but it's the truth. And I guess it's like people that sell their soul to the devil for money. And yeah, it's real.
I also watched half of the documentary on Illuminati, but it is real and it's everywhere. It's everywhere and it's taking over. And like she said, with certain songs, I listened to Michael Jackson's song Money, and he said it like, sell his soul for money, and that's what it is. It's people, they want money and they want to be famous, so they sell their soul. It's real. And some people try to argue with you about it, that it's not real, that you're being brainwashed and everything like that, but it's real and it's signs and it's symbols. It's telling you that it's out there.
Amen.
people not paying attention. Some people are, but they twisted it and they making it seem like it's not, but it's there. And it's
real.
I agree with you when you said that there's symbols and signs to let us know that it's out there. I agree with you when you said that there's symbols and signs to let you know that it's out there, but some people just don't understand it. Like one time I saw a Rihanna video with Jay-Z and Kanye West, and they was talking about how they gonna run the town and how they taking over. So I, like I said, I agree.
I know that it's real because to my age, I gotta watch out for all these signs that people are doing, and I gotta be careful what I say and what I do for everything. And it's bad because we shouldn't have to live in a world where people are selling themselves to the devil.
Amen.
I'm reminded that Eminem once said, "I sold my soul and I might never get it back."
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Dre said, "I'll sell my soul for $1 million." How about it? I don't know who was he talking about, Illuminati, was he alluding to Illuminati? But such artists that are believed to be, now let me preface this by saying such artists that are believed to be mixed up in Illuminati, Dr. Dre, Nas, Eminem, Rihanna, Beyonce, Kanye, Jay-Z. I said believe. Even the late Tupac Shakur. Tupac's last project, his last project, he made a reference to Illuminati. And Jay-Z's first project made a reference. So it just goes to show you that this spirit, this demonic force called Illuminati, let me just say, it just didn't get here when they came on the scene.
That's right.
It was instituted actually in 1776. Now, it came from a gentleman who was over in Europe, brought it over here, brought the practice of it over here. And so that tells you it was in the inception, beginning of our country.
That's right.
So Satan has been setting this generation up for previous years. He's been setting you up with this spirit called Illuminati. And some of the young folk, I caution you, don't get caught up into doing a whole lot of research where it becomes so fascinating to you that it becomes you want to be a part of it. You have to be careful when you're doing research and looking into these demonic influences that are coming from the devil, because you can get caught up in it,
yes,
and
sir,
not even know it.
That's right.
And when somebody wave $1 million in your face and you haven't done anything to earn it, be careful.
Amen.
That's all I'm trying to say.
Amen.
I sold my soul and I might never get it back. I'll sell it for $1 million. That's a tale within itself regarding the spirit of Illuminati.
And he said in this song, we're going to run this town tonight. He said, "We begin with the church leaders." It's in a lot of the songs, but it's not just for him. It goes way back, all the way to the times where demonic worship had started even inside of Babylon.
Yes, sir.
They worship Ashtaroth.
That's right.
And Ashtaroth had a wife. Solomon was accused of allowing it.
He allowed, that's right, he allowed it.
but he allowed it because his wife, one of his wives, her beliefs came from out of that. So we have always seen that. We've been seeing him as a judge of Israel who was worshiping and serving God named Jephthah. And he said to the Lord, if you allow me to win, not who you think. He said, I'll offer the human sacrifice.
That's what he said.
God ain't never required a human sacrifice. And he said, I'll offer up a human sacrifice to you. And he said, the first person that greets me when I come home from there, and I'll offer up to you.
Yes, he did.
And he killed him. Mm-hmm. And God never asked for a human sacrifice.
Amen.
Now, I'm saying to you that there are parents out there that are sacrificing their children.
Junior, come on.
They're sacrificing for selfish reasons. Now, we're sitting up here, there's three preachers up here, there's one over there, there's four more, three more out there. Do you children have any questions for us?
Come on. Great.
Okay, so a woman like saying that you have to kill somebody?
That's the belief behind it. I'm not going to say that they can kill them. I'm going to say that's the belief behind it. Or if they might, they have to offer for a sacrifice to save them.
Okay, so you know Jennifer Huss and her nephew had died? I think that not trying to put it on her, I think that she had. Put it like she tried to kill her nephew to do that, I think, because my mom was telling me that about Jennifer Hudson that she tried to pretend that she didn't do it to kill. I don't know who killed Jennifer Hudson's nephew, but I think that Jennifer Hudson pretended that she didn't kill.
Let me just say, let us keep our focus on this, on the general aspects of the effects of the work of Christ. It's not for us to say who's involved.
Yes, come on.
It's not for us to say who has taken part in that. So I strike that from the books.
Come on, that's right, that's right.
I strike that from the books, just in case you're watching. But we want to be very careful, and I caution you to be careful with that. Well, first of all, we have to be careful because that which you don't know, you haven't been privy to or haven't been witness to, you cannot put it out there inside your space. So let us be careful that we not utilize names and just toss around accusations. Notice when I said believe to me.
Right.
I didn't say they were.
Right.
You know, so that's you have to be careful. We have to be careful with the story.
When we the songs, that's just gonna be good with that. Yeah. But the general idea behind we're not gonna say because if you say we didn't we're just gonna deal with the general tone. See, because you're going to grow older, we don't know what you guys are going to be. You might be, somebody might be a professional singer, dancer, and you don't know. Because according to some of those entertainers who were not able to accept, they're entertainers who were not able to accept. If you watch the documentary, the preacher that's doing it, the black preacher that does it, there's another tape for that a white church has out. Mm-hmm. They did, they said that goes back to Elvis and Pat Boone and all of that.
Yes, right, that's right.
It's been around for a long time. They just start accepting blacks.
And they don't
care.
Yes, sir.
They like, let the black folks do drugs, make money and do drugs. That's what they do. Mm-hmm. And, you know, spend their money on Cadillacs. They always have had a low opinion of us anyway. And I'm not even trying to make this a race thing. I'm just speaking the truth. Yeah. There's always been a low opinion of us. Like, even in the movie The Godfather, they talked about bringing drugs on.
That's right.
They
give it to the people.
Have no soul. To the black folks. Exactly. Let them do drugs.
Yes, sir.
See what I'm saying? So it's always been a look. We don't want to say that Jennifer Hudson did it and nobody else did. You know, we don't want to admit not to believe it. We'll strike that later. But we want to say that they do believe that you have to make some type of sacrifice. But I'll tell you this. It goes deeper than that. Their parents sacrifice their kids all the time. And I don't feed you. If I don't clothe you.
Come on.
And if I don't stick around,
Come on.
Raise you. And if, when I don't teach you Jesus, I just offer you up as a
sacrifice. That's right, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Amen. They offer up as a sacrifice.
Amen.
Because guess what? The world is going to be destroyed.
Yes, sir.
If you don't teach Jesus.
Thanks. Amen.
Let me just say, and I'm going to go back a little bit far. Because all this was introduced in the dark.
Come on.
Because when Satan introduced himself to Eve, he made sheep. What he did was he kind of like, he got control of her thinking capacity, her mind. And so then once he did that, he seduced her will. And if we look at what scripture says, that he made her think that God was withholding something from her through the spirit of deception. So in all false religions, and I'm not going to call them names, I was in all.
All.
And I'm not going to call them people. But in all false religion, it is a practice of deception. Because with Eve, we know that the serpent lied and said that God said, the day you do this, you'll be like him. Well, the Lord said, when those of us who study scripture and believe scripture,
he said, what? Ask me for what you want. No good thing, but I'm opposed for you. You don't have to go to false gods, all these other deities, in order to receive what you want of this world. Anything that you want, if you're willing to work for it. Now, let me say that again. I said work for it. Bible says, man, don't work, you don't eat.
Yeah.
So if you're willing to work for it, now you can ask the Lord, and he will guide your footsteps in accomplishing that what you are asking him for. You know, so you don't have to go to all of these. We ain't got to call no people names. I don't know who to worship and what.
Amen.
All I know is that as Christians, we want to worship one Lord, and that's God himself.
Amen.
One baptism. And that's in Christ Jesus. But it all started
in the Garden of Eden.
Yes, sir.
When Satan deceived Eve. And sometimes we seem to think that I'm doing this, but it don't involve nobody else.
Anytime anyone
is living in sin, you involve people.
Mm-hmm. That's right, you involve.
I've heard people tell me, say, well, I ain't bothering nobody. What I'm doing is just me. No.
Yeah,
anytime you in sin, it involves somebody else.
Yes, sir. Can't do it by yourself.
It always involves somebody.
Come
sin
on.
Always involves somebody. Because look at what Eve did. Eve what? Took of the fruit. And then the problem came in, really came in, when she involved her husband in it. Because she turned into him.
Amen.
So it involves people. So don't think just because, the young people really would get on this talking about the lesbians and homosexuality. But it seems like that's what we're being attacked at today, spiritually. But we also dealing with murder. All these spirits of it, we have to understand that Satan has angels on assignment also. So that's the spirit of deception that's going on with our young people. And it's not only with our young people. It's with some of our old folks. And some of them. You know, I mean, don't think that young people are the only ones that you see practicing homosexual.
Oh, come on. Hey. Amen.
We got a bunch of old folks here.
What's up?
You know, so you know, but I'm loving that they have given young people perspective of what's going on.
Yes, sir.
You know, but it all started, I believe it all started in the dark.
Amen.
With Satan.
Amen.
Amen.
One more question, Mr. Pastor Pat. You said Illuminati is kept on your research, and as I was sitting there, I found out about Illuminati. Very concentrated place from a Caucasian young lady, teenager, that told me all this. And, you know, it's kind of like went bad because I'm a spiritual person. But then now I'm hearing, but I still don't know about Illuminati. So, how do we? You
what I'm saying. How are we going to educate?
Well, when I said when I said research, I meant don't get so engulfed in it. Notice I said afterwards that you become fascinated.
Come on.
See, when people become fascinated with issues or subjects, they go the extra and they dig deeper and deeper and deeper. And I was cautioning the young people because sometimes you can just get so deep where it just becomes so much a part of your psyche that you can't let it go and it begins to engulf your world. That's what I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
You understand? I got you. So
he's saying that there's in anything that we as Christian folk, some Christian people are not ready.
Come on.
Jesus did not take all the disciples.
That's right. Come on.
Take the healed. Because all of them were not spiritually ready. They are some demonic realms that whether people want to believe it or not, that you can cross into that you're not spiritually able to handle. Mm-hmm. And that can actually with some damage done to you.
That's
you're
right.
Not ready to go into those realms to handle some sick type of things. So you may not want to go in depth into study. Like you may be sitting up there listening to the music. And I know even myself, there are some songs that they stay with you. They have lingering effects. And you find yourself humming more too. Right? And you know good and well. You know, there's that old song that said, if you want to get funky, you know, and I still remember that song. And when I remember that it has lingering effects. So can you imagine in your study of something that is demonic, you're going to come up with demons there.
Amen.
When you're studying in the demonic, you're going to meet demons in your study. I teach a class on world religions, and I have to research stuff about food.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to meet demonic spirits there. Thanks be unto God.
Come on, hallelujah.
And so Jesus here.
Amen.
So we still have, and you have to prep, you have to pray. Do something. You might want to fast, though, before
come on.
You go and study something. Right now, good in Jesus, then study. Or get under a teacher that will only give you as you go, give you just enough so you can stay away from it. Because you don't want to even be listening. The kids, that's why there's some spiritual damage done in search. All this rap mess. All this rap mess. While young ladies are accepted being called, you know, names and stuff like that. And young men, they sag their pants, show them different colors of their drawers every day. Some of them the same colors, but they don't change them. So that's just never talking to y'all. Because they get this from out of a prison mentality. And that's demonic. It's all demonic. Give them the word first. Give them the word first. When they feelings of inadequacy.
Right.
And you know, and they feeling like, well, you know, as a Christian, I ain't gaining. I'm like, well, for a long stop for a minute, your daddy who controls everything. The earth is the Lord's. And the fullness thereof. The world and they will therein. You see what I'm saying? When they feeling like they gotta be fearful and scared. No, they don't got to be filled with the Lord is my light and my salvation.
Whom shall I be?
Even when my enemies and my foes come over me, they kill my flesh, they stumble. Feed them and put them in the word first.
Come on.
We got to put them in the word.
Amen.
We got to.
Amen.
We got to call on the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You'll bring about any dark words.
You know, even Satan tried to make Jesus
healing.
Right. When he went out into the wilderness,
yes, sir.
He said, all of these nations I'll give unto you if you would just fall down and worship me. So, and if you look at what's going on in our society, you're looking at a materialistic thing, the bling bling, and all of the name brand clothing that people have. You know, and it kind
of we here at Pastors United, we thank you for tuning in to our Pastors United Youth Forum. We thank God for you. We hope that something has been said Some of you have been enlightened by our youth in their discourse of the Word of God and in their everyday life. We thank God for our panel of discussion, Pastor Jones, Pastor Marshall, and myself, Pastor Kathy. Tune in next time when we'll have part two of our Pastors United Youth Forum. May God continue to bless and keep you.
Oh, amen. Okay.